This is Brush Hour. This is normally a miniature painting stream where our goal is to get minis tabletop ready for your DCC, MCC, X-Crawl game, whatever role-playing game you like to play. We're here to kind of just paint some minis and get them on the table so that they can look cool while they're busy dismantling your players. Over the last month and a half or so, we've been painting miniatures up. You can see a lot of them here on camera right now. We did some fur and some texture streams where we painted a boar and what has affectionately become known as the Psycho Bear, as well as a couple of unicorns, a sort of a gory, dark unicorn inspired by the unicorn encounter in Queen of Elfland's Son, and then a kind of Shin Megami Tensei inspired Kelpie unicorn. So today is kind of our last brush hour of the year. We are going to finish these off as well, including an iron golem that I did as kind of to test out some paints. So we're going to talk about basing. Basing is generally more in line with like your traditional war gamers. But it's something that I like to do because I do war gaming when I'm not playing role-playing games. And it's a way to kind of tie the miniatures, whether that's like a player character miniature or a monster miniature, to sort of the environment. In terms of war gaming, it's a really quick and easy way to tie an army together. You can kind of see here in the bottom, like what the minis are standing on. I have a lot of very similarly painted bases. We'll kind of talk about this for an army that I'm working on for a Warhammer game. So let's kind of talk about sort of the two main ways to do basing. Brushes the Gathering. So the kind of the two main ways to do basing is with like a kind of your standard flat base, whether that's like an old or like a base like you see on the Psycho Bear here, or like an old slotted base that you would see with some older mi metal miniatures. Something that is basically flat, doesn't have a lot of detail on it, and is really like ripe for playing with texture. And basing grit, which is really just sand. And then the other type of basing that usually is kind of done is with like scenic bases. So these bases that I have here are plastic injection molded bases that all have, there's like, as you can kind of see, there's like three or four different styles. But they've already got like the texture, the detail, the design already on the base. We also have resin cast bases that kind of give you the same sort of like feeling and vibe. It's there are ways to just very quickly say, this is a group that's from the same place. They all are going to be based on the same thing that sort of helps visually draw them together. So if we get time, well, actually, not even get to it. These bases here were really easy to do. Basing doesn't have to be very difficult. You can use a couple of like quick techniques. I'm more really just going to kind of explain the process with these bases, and then we'll actually do a lot of our basing with the minis over here. So if you have any questions in the chat, feel free to ask them. There is technically a channel point redemption that you can do for pick a color, any color. But I realistically only have two. I have shades of brown and bright, vibrant blue, and the urge is to just go with the vibrant blue for everything. We're gonna kind of keep things sort of themed. So these bases here, they're painted very simply. These were primed gray, and then I painted them with a contrast paint. So a very heavy gray contrast paint. This is the Citadel Basilicatum gray. I wanted to make sure that I left some of the contrast paint to dry so you get color variations. And then once it was done, once that base had dried, I went in with the Vallejo model color Verdis glaze or verdigris glaze and the Army Painter dry rust effect paint. So for the dry rust, I took my dry brush and put some onto my brush, and I just kind of dabbed it around randomly on the bases to create the splotches of rust. And then when that was done and that had dried, I thinned down the remaining rust effect and put it into like all of the little crevices and lines on there. And then I kind of took places where the verdigris might make sense and just kind of dabbed it in just to add a little splotch of color. Really simple. These bases are basically almost done. The only thing I have to do is paint the rims black, and then I can start gluing models to them. So that's one way to deal with your basing, is to use scenic bases, and let the designs of the bases do a lot of the heavy lifting for us. You can do the same thing with like this resin cast one. I can prime it, I can hit it with a contrast paint or a wash, and I can paint it to the effect that I like. But we're going to be playing with more traditional kind of like basing techniques. So let's go ahead and let's talk about, let's use our examples here. So I have two black bases. These are from WizKids as part of their like miniatures line. They just make and sell packs of their round bases. So I'm gonna kind of walk you through how like basing works with them, and then we'll start to apply it to our actual minis. So when you think of painting your miniatures, we had been talking about like a base coat or an undercoat, a mid-tone and a highlight. And you can kind of think of your basing materials in that same way. So we have this grit that I have, and this is actually a combination of these two. Let's see if this will work on camera. So I have essentially fancy sand. I've got two different like varieties of or coarsenesses of the basing material. So I have a real fine sand essentially and a coarser one. Combine them together and you get something that mixes and looks pretty realistic. So this is going to be our base coat for our bases. We're going to put this down and then we're going to put other things on top of it. As you can see here with this horse, I have, you can see this kind of in full effect. There's some of that fine basing grit, and then some of the more like thicker pieces mixed in. And then on top of that, I also have like some grasts and some tufts to really sort of help bring the idea that this horse is standing around grazing, waiting for the adventurers to come back out of the dungeon, waiting for monsters to attack it because the adventurers didn't leave anyone to guard the horse. You know, however you really want to do that. So at a very high level, when I do basing with materials like this, it's the grit as my base coat. I let that dry, and then I go in with a wash to kind of help tie the colors together, darken it up a bit, let that dry, and then I glue grass tufts of grass or moss to the base. So we're gonna go ahead and start with this. I'm gonna move my bases out of the way, and because I don't need to get any grit on them. And we are going to start with these. So one base I'm going to do with the basing grit. The other base I'm going to do with kind of the second thing that you can do, which is a texture paint or a texture paste. This is the Vallejo ground texture. This is an acrylic. It's basically it says rough gray pumice. It's so it's like a paint plus sand mixture. And you can combine these techniques. You can keep them different. It just kind of depends on how you want to use them. So we're gonna come back to this stuff, and we're gonna start with the easy way. So the first thing that we're gonna do for our base, I'll move one of these off to the right, is start with good old-fashioned white PVA glue. Now I've got the brand that we probably all know and have seen for years. White PVA glue, just your basic multi-purpose white glue, is gonna be really all we need for this. So, I'm just gonna go ahead and apply it to my base. And you can be kind of like liberal with this. You can put a lot on here. Essentially, what we want to do is we want it to coat the base. So, actually, and get my grippy do. We're going to put this base onto my grippy do so that I can paint this out a little bit better. And I've got a really kind of old junky brush that I use for specifically for basing. So I'm going to put it into some clean water just to kind of wet it up a little bit. And then I'm just going to just use the brush to move the glue where I want it. And you can kind of spread it out, you know, even it out. I'm going to use like a kind of a circular motion to sort of spread it out until it covers all the surfaces of the base. And if you get a little overhang or if you miss a couple spots, that's okay. It doesn't have to be even, it just has to have a little bit of glue in each spot. All right. And the next step is you can like let this sit for a little bit. I'm gonna rinse out my brush while we're doing that, because I don't need the extra glue in the brush. You can also use a little bit of water to help thin this out if you're having trouble spreading it around. But once you have the glue on the base, we are going to, there's kind of two ways you can do it. If you're, you know, prone to making a mess, or if you want to make a mess, you can just, let's see if I can get something that'll help here. You can accidentally spill it like that, which that's fine. So the first way you can do it is just sprinkle it on top. Like that's, you just grab handfuls, fingerfuls of the basing material and sprinkle it all over the base. Now this obviously, as you can kind of see, it's making a mess of my work area. There's basing material all over the place. So that's kind of one thing to be, you know, be aware of, is that you're just kind of sprinkling this like you might season some food. So realistically, sprinkling higher is better in that regard. And then you can kind of even it out by sort of just tapping it, tapping the base as you sort of rotate it to get anything that's loose back into the bowl. The other way you can do it is even messier, is to kind of just sort of sprinkle it on a lot. And I'm going to do the same thing. I have a lot sitting on the base, and I'm just going to kind of pour it back in and rotate it as I do. So these are the kind of very messy ways to go about that. There's a little bit more over here that I can put on. It looks like I missed some spots there. But this is ideally like the first way you can go about putting basing materials onto your bases. It's really messy at the moment for me because this has like, there's not a whole lot of free space in here. But the other way you can do it is, clear this off, is to take the container that the basing material came in and treat it like you're gonna bread this to deep fry it. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to grab one of our boars. I'm going to go ahead and put a little bit of glue right on his base. And I'm not being super neat with this. I don't want to get this the glue onto the model itself. So I do have to be careful in that regard, but I do want to spread the glue out and make sure that it covers all of the base. If it gets up onto the sides, that's okay in this instance because it's got like that ground texture, and having a little bit of the basing material get up on that will help sort of fill in the gaps visually. So the other way we can do it is to just drop this in like it's some breadcrumbs, let it sit for a moment, and then pull it out and kind of rotate it, tap the sides of the base. You can see some of the basing material got onto the sides of the base. So I'm just gonna use my finger to kind of clean this up. And I noticed a little spot here in the back that I didn't get with glue. And we'll just do that. We'll take and put a little bit on before I clean my brush off and let that sit. So those are kind of the two ways you can sort of add your basing grit. They're both pretty messy. If you do have like a bigger container of your mixed basing grit, you can do what I did with the with this one with the boar. And that way you don't have to worry about sprinkling it or spilling it like I did. So if there's any questions, go ahead, ask them in the chat. You can there's tons of like tutorials and stuff out there, a couple different techniques on how to do this. I'm essentially using a technique that a friend used in like 2012. It works for me, just because it's something that I think looks pretty good on a base. So that's one way to do it. What we'll do with this is normally I would let this dry for about 24 hours, and then hit it with a wash to darken it up. One of the other things that you can do with this is if you do the base first, or if you like glue the model to the base and then put your basing grit on it, you can actually prime this with the rest of your miniature, and then you can change the color. So like maybe I want this to be like gray rocks. Now there are the basing companies do have like gray rocks that you can use. I can just go out and get sand, like construction sand from hardware store. That works great too. It's also dirt cheap. It's like a 50-pound bag for like 10 bucks. But priming it or putting it on first, putting the model on, and then priming it gives me a lot of like color. I can then work with it and paint it like I would anything else. So we're gonna let these guys dry while we kind of talk about the second one, the second way. And I'm gonna go ahead and pull that base off. Oops, almost spilled the other basing grit that I have. All right. So go ahead and put this on. So the other style using the like texture paint. I'm trying to actually see if I have any other texture paint from other companies. I do technically have some technical paint. So the texture paint that I have here is designed to go on kind of before you paint. You can treat it like we did with the basing grit. So I can put it on after the model's done. But this is like a goopy compound. We can, so this is one that we probably won't be playing too much with tonight, because it has a 90-minute dry time. So it's going to be like, as we're wrapping up, maybe I can do something with this. But you can also, one of the cool things about these is you can also like color it or tint it with your paints before you start to work with it. It gives you a lot of like, you can build up the textures, you can put extra layers on. They make different sort of grits for this. I know it doesn't kind of read too well on the camera because it's gray, but it does, you know, we can go ahead and play around with this. So, unlike the last time where I used a brush, this time instead I am going to use a sculpting tool that I have. You don't need to use this. You don't need to go out and get one of these. You can use a plastic spoon. You can use a paintbrush. But I am essentially just going to scoop this up and just sort of apply it to this base wholesale. So actually, I don't know why I'm not just rotating this like it's a mini, and why am I rotating the whole holder? But yeah, so we can just kind of like smooth this out. You know, if you've ever iced a, frosted a cake, you know, you can treat it like that. We're just looking to create a smooth layer. You can create textures with this. So, because this stuff has such a long dry time, you also have a lot of like, a lot you can do, like building up. Like, I can just put a big thick glob on there. I can thin this out, bring it all the way to the edge of the model or of the base. Basically, we just want to kind of smooth this out and then like let it dry or get or kind of put the effects on it that we want. So we can go ahead and just get that out there. And so I can like, let's say I want to make this look like a couple of wagon wheels have gone through it. So I can also just kind of carve through the grit, and I can make this look like muddier. I can, you know, put ho little horse horse prints in the wagon tracks, just sort of dirty this up. This also you could clean in a cup of water. I'm not going to use it because my paint cup is, I don't need it in there. So I'm just gonna kind of like scrape it off back into the jar here, and once it my once my tool or my spoon or whatever is mostly clean, I'm just gonna go take like some paper towel or some napkin and just kind of wipe this off so that it is clean. So just like with the last one, we're really just gonna kind of let it sit, let that dry. That's something we can come back to kind of at the end. I'm glad you liked that rust effect. It's I it was something I was kind of toying around with. And I wasn't sure if it was going to work. All right. So I'm just gonna set that there. So those are kind of like the two sort of major ways that you can paint up your bases is kind of scenic bases like we did there, or at the beginning, or you can use like basing grit to make your own. See. I have something else that could be interesting. You know what? Yeah. Kind of in the same vein as the texture paint is some companies, specifically Citadel, will make what they call technical paints. Technical paints is just the line that they have for paints that do fancy effects. When we did the unicorn a couple last week, or when we finished it off, we used their technical blood paint. So blood for the blood god is for painting blood. This is a paint called Mordant Earth, and this cracks. So actually I'm not going to do it with this because that is one that I use regularly. So we are going to come back here to the scenic base that I have. And we are going to, oh, that's what we're going to do with this. We're going to put some bile underneath it. And we're going to then put the mordant earth on top of it. So these paints that crackle, you want to put them down last. You can do stuff with them after the fact. So you can go in and say, hey, I would like, I want you to paint it a different color. Games Workshop, their Citadel color paints, they do a really good job though of like having like here's a Mars colored, or like a red earth or a tan or black. Mordant earth is for like lava and magma effects. So I'm actually gonna do their Vallejo acid in those crevices, and then I'm going to do the bile on top. So like everything else, and then I'm gonna glop it on with this mordant earth. All right, so I need a brush. And we're just going to wet our brush. And we're not going to be very careful at all because this is, I mean, one thing this model is, or this base is not primed. That is something that I would do normally. But I think, showing off the sort of different types of kind of basing paints or ways to base, I think is going to be a little bit more important than making sure that this base I had is primed. I'm also not going to use this base for my armies because the company that makes them went out of business, so I can't get them anymore. So while I'm applying this dark, dark green, has any big plans anyone have for the holidays? Who knew my engagement was down when Nyx isn't here?
Yeah, I was actually just thinking that, like, huh, where's Nyx?
They are upstairs watching Sleeping Beauty with my wife.
Oh. Well, dang it, Nyx.
I know, right?
How dare they?
How dare they indeed. Hosting dinner. Ooh, what's for dinner? We had chicken Alfredo tonight.
Oh, now I want chicken Alfredo.
I
Man, I had spaghetti.
mean, I'm fine with spaghetti. Spaghetti's great.
I am too, but I wish it had been fresh. It was leftovers.
Oh, that's fair. Have a lot of leftovers that we have to work through, and we're making a fresh dinner tonight. So it's like, maybe we should have had a leftovers night, but that's all right. Hosting dinner for the holidays, doing the whole turkey dinner. Ooh, all right. If you're doing the whole turkey dinner, I gotta ask, what's your go-to side for turkey dinner? Because like everyone's got like, or I guess I should say, not even just like specifically turkey dinner, because everyone probably thinks like stuffing or mashed potatoes. But like if you were going to a holiday, well, we'll start with just one, and then we'll all decree that that's the wrong choice, and then we'll fight it out as to what is the actual best.
It'll be a fist fight in the chat.
Yeah. Fist fight on Twitch. That's never happened before.
No, never.
I am not being like careful or thinning out this bile paint or this acid paint too much at all. I want it to be like thick and vibrant, which priming would have helped, but that's okay. So we're just gonna kind of slapdash this on, let it dry, and then we'll hit come back and hit it with the mordant earth. Stuffing is the best, and then you mix. Oh, you lost me with that last one. I am not a fan of turnips.
Ah, I see, Dice Station Zebra has really become one with the Rutabaga Riot now. They did a whole campaign on Honor Among Thieves where it was just all root vegetable themed with vegetable puns all around,
Okay.
so, it's funny. Embrace the root vegetables.
I turnips have to be like the one root vegetable I don't like too much, which is a bit of a shame because we had this delicious stew last week that had turnips in it. It was like chicken, apple, butternut, squash, and turnips. And I love the stew. I just don't like the turnip parts of it.
Yeah,
Okay.
I don't know if I've ever had turnips.
It's like a really bitter carrot, is like the best way I would describe it. Like texturally, flavor-wise, it's got a very distinct taste to it, and that's really where it messes me up. Yeah, it's
Interesting.
very, very strong.
I can see how cutting it with mashed potato would be good.
Especially when that mashed potato is also cut with large amounts of heavy cream and butter.
And throw in some like garlic in there.
Oh yeah. All right.
Now I'm hungry. Why do we have to talk about food?
Well, it's the holidays. You're always supposed to talk about food at the holidays.
I guess. But yeah, no, I think I'm with you that Dye Station Zebra is wrong.
That stuffing is the best. Yeah, I mean stuffing's great. Will never turn down stuffing at a holiday dinner. I'm just not built that way. I'm not made of stone. But like, I think when it comes to like a good holiday side, it's probably got it has to be something, like more unique to the. More unique to the holiday. So like, man, I'm trying to remember, like, see, that's the problem is usually my Christmas dinner is like ham and macaroni and cheese. That was like traditionally what we had. But I guess you could do like the best sort of holiday side for me, I guess just because of it would have to be mac and cheese for me just because of growing up. Like that was always what we had. We would go over to my aunt's house and she would make like macaroni and cheese, starting with like a roux and a bechamel sauce, and then like just oodles of cheese and cream. So that would be, but I'm not gonna turn down gravy or stuffing and gravy and mashed potatoes and all right. I've
Oh,
lost her.
I think mine is going to make everyone cheer, or it's going to make everyone want to pummel me into the ground.
All right. Well, I will reserve judgment.
So I grew up in the South, obviously
Okay.
by my voice, and I don't know what it is, but every Christmas, like my grandmother or some other member of my family makes this amazing potato salad.
Okay.
So we have a ham in the center, surrounded by everything else, like deviled eggs, green beans, and like rice and lima beans, and then there's just this big bowl of potato salad.
Okay, all right. What's in is it all right, is it a hot potato salad? Like are we
No, it's a
talking
cold
German?
potato salad.
It's a cold potato
Oh,
salad?
it's
Okay.
cold.
I don't think I've ever had that for a holiday. Like that always potato salad always like reads to me as like summer
Yes.
cookout. I'm not gonna pummel you for that. I don't know if, I think I'd be like, why is there potato salad here?
It's so
Matt,
good.
oh,
Put it
I'm
on the
sure.
honey roast, like the honey
The
coated
ham?
ham, and
All
like
right.
the ham's warm. You've got your green beans that are warm. The rice right next to it is like milk rice, so it's like milk and sugar, and like you put that, and then you've got this cold thing of potato salad that's just refreshing.
Okay. All right. It makes sense.
And then you got to top it off with my grandmother makes Apple Betty, which is basically just a cobbler.
Yeah.
And it's, whew. That is like they make it in this 13x9 casserole dish, and it never has leftovers.
Dang.
Ever. Like, if you don't go back for seconds when you're immediately done with your first serving, you have missed out because everyone else has already eaten the rest.
All right. Well, I mean, cobbler and, apple betties are generally delicious. Oh, that is not going to work at all. So one of the things that I'm kind of doing while we're talking about delicious food is I've gone back to that first base And I have started to apply a wash. I'm just applying the Army Painter Soft Tone. So I'm just basically trying to fill in those recesses. And you're going to kind of see as I'm doing this why I like to wait 24 hours. So I've got the wash on my brush, and I'm not really able to spread it around like I would any other like model that I paint. And the reason is like you can kind of see as I'm pushing or painting, the basing grit is still sitting in wet glue, so it's shifting as I'm painting it. But you can already start to see like there's more definition, there's more depth to the color, because I am like I'm going through and I'm just saying, hey, here is, here's the color that I would like. You can use any sort of wash, any kind of shade, incredibly thin down paint. So we're gonna get kind of weird with some of the stuff that we'll see here. I'm gonna show you like how changing your wash or changing your shade can change the way that this looks. So I'm now switching to a blue shade over here on the far side. Again, I'm running into the sort of the same issue that I did on the other side, is that it's not dry. So the basing material is moving around, which can also then lead to the basing, like to the sand coming off once the model's done, because you've kind of killed sort of the tackiness of it. Kind of the different sort of the adhesive properties of the glue. That's the one I was looking for. So, and doing something like this, it can be really good if you're trying to do like testing, is like get yourself a big base or a piece of cardboard, paint it up how you want, see how the wash reacts to it, and then just let it dry and do the things that you want to do to it. What I'll probably do with this and the other piece is there is like a you can do like a dry brush palette, which is essentially just a square or a rectangle that has a whole bunch of like modify or like glued like plastic pieces, old model bits, vehicle parts, and it gives you an idea to like how your dry brushing or your contrasts are going to look. And it also lets you dry brush on those things so you can get the paint to the right consistency. It's not something I've done because I don't super feel that it's necessary, but it is something that can be interesting to do. All right, so let's see. Let's do. You grab a contrast paint. So we've done two different types of washes, and I'm going to try seeing how this Bad Moon Yellow looks as a contrast paint over the grit in the center. But this is essentially what I try to do when basing, is put down my base, let it dry, hit it with a wash, and then let that dry, and then I can come in and do whatever else I need to do, which is going to be kind of interesting here with this contrast paint. It's a lot more yellow than I was expecting. But I guess as it's paint and not wash, it is designed to tint things more. Actually, you know what? Now that I think about it, I have a better answer for my holiday side. It's a dessert that my mom used to make. She still does. It's just a lot more time consuming for her to do it. But it is essentially like it's like a cheese Danish essentially. But she does it in a casserole dish, and it's like a cream cheese mixture that has a like a couple layers of like biscuit dough that's just, canned biscuit dough. And you roll it out, you throw it on, you cover it with like an egg wash and some cinnamon sugar, and then you bake it. and the biscuit dough puffs up just enough. And the cream cheese like bakes and gets all nice and delicious as cream cheese mixture does. And it's like probably one of the like biggest holiday traditions next to that like mac and cheese. But that's a dessert and not a side, and I did ask for sides, so. All right. So those kind of just sort of the basics of what we're doing with the basing is, again, just the basing grit down, then a wash. And then what we can do is start to add little effects, little accoutrements, if you will. And these can come in a kind of a variety of different styles and types. So we have the sand, it's basing grit, it's designed to give us a good foundation and some texture. The kind of the next thing that you will do, especially if you look up like old Warhammer models, is static grass. So you can buy these, you can buy static grass at like any sort of like hobby shop, any sort of like model train shop, and it's comes in like clumps. You can buy a big like spice jar of it essentially. But this, what this allows you to do is to do like I did with the basing material, is to just put like a little bit of my white glue down, and I can spread that out with my brush. I can leave it, whoops, I can leave it like that. So I'm going to spread it just ever so slightly. I'm actually going to thin this down with some water to spread it out a lot easier and just kind of create a little patch of grass. And then while that glue is still nice and tacky, I'm going to come over here. I'm going to grab a little pinch of the static grass and I'm just going to sprinkle it on. And I'm just going to kind of push it down and get it into place. And just like I did with the basing material with the grit, oops, I'm going to just sort of tap it a little bit and get any kind of the extras off. And then sort of kind of just try to make it sort of stand a little bit. The big reason why this is generally called static grass is because there is an applicator that you can use. That will, using static electricity, it will actually cause the like grass points to stand on end so that you don't get this like weird sort of mat of like fake grass. You get something that's standing up and looks a little bit more lively. As I'm trying to show it off camera. There we go. Let's see if it'll focus on it a little bit better. Nope, but it really threw my white balance off. So it's just like a mat of just fake grass. Now, generally, I don't like to use the static grass because I don't have one of those applicators. So instead, I have. What's the difference between these two? Nothing. These are identical. They just look slightly different. One of the other things you can do is you can buy Hobby Flock, which is very similar to static grass. It's just a little bit clumpier. This is a nice like autumn blend that I have, and it works the same way. So I can open up my little container. If I want to get fancy, I can apply this with tweezers. I can stick this, and what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna stick this on with my fingers. Is let's go ahead, spread that out a little bit more. So right now what I'm doing is I've got that sort of intersection between the unwashed grit and the yellow. And so I'm just gonna kind of spread that there to just get an idea of what it looks like kind of in the center. And I'm just going to take some clumps and stick it on. And just kind of get that there. And I don't have to be neat with any of this. These are things that are just going to kind of like look good at a distance. And just kind of let that dry. So sorry about it pulling off camera. I was trying to get it. I was trying to blow some excess away. So we can see here that it's, you know, how does it look? This is generally, again, you're gonna generally go into this with a plan, but I'm just showing off kind of the different techniques of how to use that stuff. So apparently I've never opened this before because there's still plastic on this.
So while you're getting that up, I just want to make a little observation, and maybe it's just 'cause I'm hungry and maybe it's because we were talking about food, but that is starting to look like somebody's Christmas dinner plate. You got the yellow like corner mac and cheese
Yep.
there. You've got
The
like in
green
the cin
beans.
yeah, the green beans over there. You've got mashed potatoes with the grass. You've got like I don't know, like some kind of gravy or something off to the side there, and then you've got the rust on top that's just like the big old plate of ham. Apparently,
mean,
I'm
it's
not the only one who thought that. Dice Station Zebra also said
All
it.
right, all right. Well, I'm not gonna tell you guys you're wrong, because I see it. I understand where you're coming from. So this is kind of just sort of like I'm just kind of getting an idea of like what I can do with this, show off the different things. The cool thing about static grass is that there's like tons of it, tons of different styles. Static grass, the flock, like this here is it's a grayish one. It's supposed to be for like snowy or ashy wastes. They make you can make your own using you can make snow using like baking soda. You'd have to generally be careful if you're using baking soda. You just basically mix baking soda and PVA or like the white glue and just slap it on like I did with the texture paint. The only problem that you really have to worry about with that combination is that it does turn yellow after some time. There are companies that do make a like a realistic like snow effect. Those you also have to be careful with because it uses crushed glass. So you know we're getting dangerous in our hobby. The other thing that you can do with your basing, and it's not something that I'm going to do tonight because admittedly I've never done it and I don't have a right base for it, but you can use water effects. This is a rebranded bottle, but this was from a snow kit that I bought, and this is actually the realistic water from Woodland Scenics. But basically you paint underneath. Kind of like the color schemes that you want, and then you pour this in, you smooth it out, or you let it level, and it will then give you a water effect. So you can do it for like lakes and rivers. You can do it for muddy puddles, mix a little bit of like brown ink in there. There's a lot, like there's so many things that like we as like miniature painters and role-playing games players can do that we can just steal from like war gamers and almost more realistically from like model trained people. So there's a lot of really cool things that you can do to make your minis really pop. I don't I was trying to find it earlier, but I also have bay po bay leaf pods or bay seed pods. Yeah, bay leaf pods. The pods that like you can get those big bay leaves. There's like little pods that they start off with. Those make great for like miniature sized leaves. So I have like an autumn foliage blend that you can kind of glue on again, just put a little white glue down and put that in. So the last thing that you can do is tufts of grass. So I've got a pile over here. I pulled out in preparation for this. So some of the tufts can be like fairly normal, like what I'm about to show you. We have a bunch of like meadow flowers. These are just kind of like you want a summertime field. They're like green with like yellow ends. You can kind of it's you can kind of tell based on the clumping of it. But over here on like this side where my thumb is moving, they're bigger tufts, and as you move to the other side, they're smaller tufts. They're on this like wax paper or parchment paper, and they're just sort of stuck on, and you can just peel them off. They've got a little bit of stickiness on the back there, but I'd like to just make sure that they've got a little bit of extra help, and I just put a little bit of glue on, just a little dab. And then I go ahead and I find where I would like to put it. Oops, and I kind of ruined this one. You want to be a lot more gentler with these than I was, but you just want to kind of put it on, and then sort of make it not look garbage like I did when I picked it up. But now, like, I've got some wildflowers. That's how I did the grass that the horse is eating on this, is I took a big old tuft and I just glued it to the base. And it just happens to look like he's eating that grass. So these tufts are really cool. I've got, like I said, I've got like meadow flowers. I have yeah. I've got like wasteland. So like I've got like kind of a dark sort of burnt grass, and it's just kind of a matter of just sort of picking it up and gluing it in place. And then some for some of the really freaky stuff, I have like weird colors. So I've got like a bright green, like a neon green, and pink. So I'm probably going to be using the pink on the Psycho Bear. And they all just apply, in the same sort of style. You just glue them on, put them into place. Try not to hold them as tightly together like I did when I was pinching them off, or kind of pulling this one off of the first paper. You can use super glue for it. You can use PVA glue. Sometimes I don't want to use super glue for this because super glue can frost. So like, I probably won't want to use it on the unicorn bases, because those can because they're on clear bases, and so I generally don't want to do that. So that is kind of the like basics. There's a lot of really cool stuff that you can do with basing. So what we're going to do now is we are going to get into this a lot more. We're going to start working on kind of the practical. So I'm going to leave this here. Here, and we're going to go with our Psycho Bear because admittedly, I have been very excited to base him for a long time now. All right, so the Psycho Bear is on like a bit of like ground or mud. I'll probably go back and like dry brush it like electric blue or something. But what I'm going to do right now is I'm just going to put some glue down and I'm going to just kind of put a bead down. Had some of the benefits of these like model holders is I can spin it without moving my hand or the model. Oops. And then I'm just going to use my brush to kind of spread this out, making sure that I get at least somewhat of an even layer. Or as best as I can, and just making sure that I pull that glue all the way to the edge and get it kind of in the crevices. So if I have small basing grit, that it will get there as well. So just making sure that there's stuff on the edge as well, because we saw with our sample base, there were parts that did not have any glue at the edge there. And so we started missing, some of the started missing some of the grit there. All right. So I know I just put him onto the model holder. I'm gonna take him off the model holder. We're going to come over here to our grit, our bright blue grit. I got this at Michael's. It was in the like miniature house gnome section. And I'm just going to like rotate him into the grit so I'm not making a mess because I've already made a pretty big one tonight. And I'm just going to keep doing that until I get blue crystals all over every aspect of this base. I'm going to pick up some and just kind of drop it over as well, minimizing the mess, but obviously I'm still making kind of a big mess. Now, what's happening here? So we saw as part of our like initial process, we did get glue all the way to the edges. But as I was turning it, or as I kind of would have piled it on, some of the glue made it into the little cup. And is on some of the crystals, and so we have stuff missing. This is also, you can kind of see here next to my finger, why you want to vary your grit size. Because if there's no grit that can fit in there, then you're just going to have a blank spot. So this is going to look kind of cool when it's done. But ideally, what I would probably do is if I could find it, I would find like smaller grit for this. So that I can mix it with the blue and have a good even coating. Some people you'll see will actually go through and they'll use like their super fine grit first and then sprinkle on some of the thicker stuff. So I'm because this is already like fairly diverse in the color, I'm just going to leave it like this. I'm not going to put a wash on it. Because I think it's fine at the moment. But I also really want, kind of want to play with some of the other things that I have for him. So let's see, that's not the pink tuft, that's green. There we go. So we've got our fantasy tuft pink from Vallejo Scenery. These are all like they're really super easy. Instructions are right on the back of the package. So it comes in different sizes and colors, ready to use by simply peeling each tuft off. Self-adherent to your base, although they can also be fixed with PVA glue, which is what I do. So I'm gonna go ahead and let's find a nice one. Let's go with this one here, this kind of L-shaped one in the corner. I'm just gonna kind of grab the edge a little bit and just peel it off. Again, I do want to be gentle because you saw with that field meadow that I, or those meadow flowers, that I kind of pinched them in such a way that made them not look right. So, whoops. Get a little bit of glue on there. A little bit too much glue, but that's okay. Then we're going to go ahead and. Now you can do this with tweezers. But my tweezers are in a different room. And you can just kind of find a spot and just sort of fix it in place with your PVA glue. And because it's white glue, you've got some time to kind of readjust it. Actually, where'd that sculpting tool go? So I'm just going to use that to help get it into place. And now I've got a little bit of like pink on the Psycho Bear's base. And I'm going to do this, a couple more times, visually make it kind of appealing with multiple options. I'm going to go for a small tuft now. And this time, I'm actually going to put this up onto the actual base that was a tat that the bear came with. That way, we've got some like little visual representation between the basing material and the bear's base itself. It's not the most level or the smoothest part. So we do have to kind of make sure that we're just kind of putting it down, and I'm just going to kind of give it a little poke. And let that glue sort of start to take place or take hold. And let's see. Let's add a little bit of color. So I say add a little bit of color, like there isn't four different neon pinks on that bear. All right. Flowers, clear bases. Let's put a green tuft on there, you know? All right, sorry, turquoise. Fantasy tuft turquoise. And we'll do just this one here. So we're gonna grab this one here. Ooh, that's bigger than I thought. Oh, that's a. Oh no, that's just. Okay, there we go. So we've got this like little crescent shape. It looks like it was still kind of connected to some of the others. So we're gonna go ahead and add a little bit of glue to this. And actually, what I'm gonna do is I want to add the glue onto the base. I'm gonna do it this way. This way I can, you know, spread it out if I need to. I also don't have to worry about like holding the base or the tuft as much while I'm trying to get that centered or situated. And just again, we're just pushing it in place. So this is you know, our bear is kind of ready, he's done, ready to go out and murder some players. Or some characters, I should say. We don't want to murder our players, then we don't have anyone to play with. But their characters are free game. So again, just like with that second piece, I'm gonna just kind of push some of this stuff down so it'll stick to the other pieces. Because we don't want anything like floating in air, because then it'll, you know, it's less strong in that way. So yeah. All right, let's take a look. Come back here. It's been about an hour. Take a look at our texture. So, still pretty damp, so we're not going to really do anything with that. All right. And kind of before we move on to sort of the next, oops, is that? There we go. The next miniature. Let's go back and take a look at that base that we did. So, painted this base with is that scenic base where I hit it with the Vallejo acid, which is just a glossy green, and the Vallejo bile, which is just kind of a glossy like neon green. So they're designed to remain glossy after the fact. And now what we're going to do is we are going to put mordant earth on, which is that technical paint I was talking about. So, technical paint, this one in particular. This technical paint is designed to crack when it dries. So the like more paint you have in an area, the bigger the cracks. So we can just kind of, it's real thick paint. We're not going to thin this because we don't want to thin it, but we're literally just going to paint this onto our base, covering like as much as we can, glooping it on, as it were. I have a really cool idea. I have a Ghost Rider model that I want to paint with a whole bunch of flames and have the whole body be cut like painted up in flames and then cover the whole body in this paint and then just watch it crack. So it looks like he's on fire. As opposed to, you know, just his head or his car or his bike, depending upon which version of Ghost Rider you like. So you can already kind of see up here the paint is starting to dry. We haven't finished covering it, and that's okay. We're just kind of, again, we're just glooping this on, getting this into where we need it. Probably should have used a junk brush for that, but we're gonna go ahead and just give our brush a really good clean in the paint cup, and we'll let that kind of sit off to the side. So we'll come back to you in a moment, little resin base. All right. Think I'm going to do is get another cup out. And we're going to put some of our blue in here. Couple pin, you know, pinches of our base, and then I've got a different, because again, I have more basing materials than sense, I guess. But I have a different battlefield brown, so it's kind of like a darker brown base than the stuff I was using originally. And I'm just gonna take a couple of big fat pinches, like I'm salting a turkey. And I'm just going to get that in there, mix that up. And then we're going to go ahead and let's see, what else do I have? That's a static grass, and that is okay. All right, that's stuff for later. Okay, so we're going to come over to our the first of our unicorns. Just like with the bear, just like with the boar, we're gonna go ahead and put some glue down. This time I'm gonna just kind of be real thick with the glue. But probably more on there than I would normally want. But this is a clear base, so I want to make sure that I get good coverage because I don't really have anything color-wise to really help me out here. So like if I had painted the bear's base like electric blue before I put the basing material on, or if I had done like any other color on the unicorn space, I could kind of go through and just make, you know, give it a little undercoat. But we're gonna go ahead and do it this way. Push these, kind of spread this out. Gonna give the unicorn here kind of a mix of pretty realistic colors with that battlefield brown and the bright blue to give it this sort of idea that maybe it's, you know, it's an incursion from Elfland, but it's not fully one place or the other. And then I am going to dump this. So to do that, I'm actually going to get something else. Oops, those are like a little tray that I can use, which I should have done earlier, had I thought about it. And I'm actually going to add a little bit more glue here to the end because you can see it's kind of retreating in from the edges. So I'm just going to add just a lot more glue so that it's all the way up to the edges. And if it's over the edges, that's fine. The PVA will dry clear. And we can then go ahead and add our basing. So I'm just going to go ahead and kind of just. Oof. That's right. So the basing materials being like two different types, we're going to run into some issues. So, like if I try to shake it, it's going to all kind of filter itself to being one type or the other. So I'm just going to pour it on and be real messy with it because it's okay because I have it in this tray, which then allows me to do a couple of other things like shake it around, gather this back up. and get a much better, much more even layer on the unicorn's basing. All right, so whoop, we can get a little overhang there. That's okay. There's a lot more of the bigger rocks on this side. There's a very clear distinction. That's okay, because this kind of gives us it gives us something to work with if we want to do anything with it. I will probably just hit this with a wash later, probably like either a light tone or maybe even that blue wash to give it sort of a glowy effect. But also, I want to let this sit for 24 hours. So in those instances, what I usually do is I will just kind of prop it up on one of these little cups and just put it like this. But I need this cup at the moment, so we'll leave it there. I'll grab another one. And for the time being, my unicorn is done. I can go through and I will add like basing tufts to it. So like I'll put some like grass tufts on it, do something to make it, give it some vegetation. So go ahead and filter this back into here so I don't have a mess. And I can always use this later. Maybe get like spice jars or what's the word I'm looking for? Like spice jars or like little containers. For that, you can then, save your mixes, so you have them later, kind of like a recipe, if you will. Let's go ahead. Let's move on and do this boar. So our first boar, we just did the very like fine grit. We're gonna go ahead and do the oh, I did. Oops. All right. So I had stuck the boars to their bases with a little bit of blue tack, because it's really useful to stick models to things. And I forgot that they were still stuck that way. So his basing's gonna change, but this guy, we got to him in time. So I'm gonna go ahead and attach the boar to his base. So I'm just gonna put a little super glue on the base. And then I guess I'll come back to him because I gotta let the super glue cure. So unfortunately, Pumbaa, you are out of commission for the rest of the night, because or maybe for the rest of the night. So we're gonna move on to this iron golem. Kind of big rocks here. I can do the sort of the basing that I did earlier. I think I'm gonna do just the battleground brown or battlefield brown. So go ahead and just put, actually, I'm gonna put some up here too on the actual base part. Just to kind of make it all look kind of a little more uniform. I want to be careful that I don't get any on the model. So that is something that you do have to be aware of. And this is messy. Like basing is there's a reason why I started off showing scenic bases, because generally that's how I prefer to do it. A painted base is just a little bit more neater for a little bit neater for me to deal with. But sometimes, you want to go kind of old school and just have like dirt and ground or grime and ground and all of that other fun stuff. And so we'll just get a little bit of this in here. Looks like the technical paint has tinted my water, which is whoop. That's a lot more glue than I needed. So it's dripping onto me. But we're just going to kind of just shake him and just dig out some of that. Oh, All right. And then, all right. So, that's not too bad actually. Not because of the a lot of the glue that was on it. He is it's not as good in the front as it is kind of around the sides and the back. And that was a mistake on my part, but I think overall not too shabby with him. Just like with the rest of these, though, I'm gonna come back and I'm going to do a wash with them. What I actually think I need to do at this point, though, is I think I need to take a quick five. I gotta clean my hands off and I need new water. Awesome. Sorry about that, everyone. Covered in glue, covered hands and things being a little bit more of a mess. Had to go swap out the paint water as well because it was starting to tint the glue. So we really just kind of have like one more model to base at the moment. And that is the Kelpie inspired model. So just like with just kind of like with the last couple, I'm actually going to do a mix of the kind of the thicker and the more fine sand. And then that should kind of like the problem with basing and kind of making sure that everything is sticking correctly is that we're going to run into this issue that we're running into now is material, like things need to dry and cure before we can really move on to the next step. But that's okay. Like, I mean, we've been going for, you know, a little, we've been going for a while and checking on our base that with the technical paint, which does not seem to be cracking as much as I would have liked. But we're gonna kind of go through, finish this up, and then we will do something that I should be doing after every brush hour, but I don't because I have built up a lot of bad habits over the years, and it's always recognizing that you have the bad habit first, right? I can't fix it if I don't recognize it. So we're gonna go ahead and we're gonna do a thin layer. So I think part of the reason why we ran into some issues is we went for a really thick layer on the iron golem, and that proved to be a bit of an issue. I think also you can see at the edges there what's happening is the glue is beading, so like you can watch here, and it's not providing an even coating. You saw it earlier; it was kind of pulling in from the sides. That's almost certainly because these bases are not primed; they're not, you know, they have nothing really on them for the glue to grab onto. And that's okay. For like our purposes tonight. But this also probably means I should be applying the glue in like smaller stages. So like do half the base, kind of come over here and sprinkle it on, and then, you know, kind of dump it back in, get a good coverage, kind of flatten some things out, clean it off a little bit, come over to the other side, put some glue down. That way we are, whoops, as I'm getting glue everywhere again. That way we're just kind of making sure we're working with smaller areas so that the glue itself doesn't have a chance to bead up like that. So come over here. Again, kind of shake it off, make sure it gets, you know, where we need to. You can see here on the front. It's not really working out the way that, you know, we really want it to. So I'm gonna just put down some glue. And again, like priming these bases beforehand probably would have gone a long way to help. I haven't worked with clear bases like this before. So I wasn't 100% sure how they were gonna react. Which really goes to show you should always just prime your models. Because otherwise they you give like mold release agents, things that would make it the paint not stick. And because I have a lot of paint or a lot of glue on this brush still, I'm just sort of using that instead of kind of making, whatever I have available, for my bottle of glue. And then we're just gonna go like this. Yeah, you can see it's a lot easier, but there's a lot of like holes in the glue. So I actually think I'm gonna probably have to just clear this off and come back in and just put like even a layer of paint on it to make sure that it sticks. We got kind of lucky with the first unicorn. I think that might have been because we put a bunch of glue on it. It's actually kind of falling off the edges at the moment. So we're gonna go ahead and just wipe this away. And I'm gonna have to make some new combined basin grid as well, because this is all covered in glue and I'm not gonna want to reuse this. So, all right, so we'll come back to the Kelpie. The model itself is still okay. Like I don't have basing material up on the horse itself or up on the unicorn. So I'm not too worried about that. It's not like I ruined a paint job. And it's always, the stuff's fixable. It's all, it's water-based glue and some paints. So I'm gonna just kind of wipe my hands to dry the paint or the glue and the base material. And we're gonna kind of move this off to the side. We'll do a quick kind of recap of some of the bases that we've been working on tonight. And then we're gonna do one final thing, which is brush maintenance and cleaning, which is something that I don't do often enough. I'm very rough on my brushes, which means I probably should do it more often. But it's something that I always just kind of forget to do. Let's see here. Oh, this will help. Oops. Clean this stuff off the side, kind of as like a bench scraper. Just kind of cleaning my workspace. I'll pick this cutting mat up and just dump this into the trash when I'm done. So let's kind of review what we did. So we had our scenic bases. Those are still off to the side. But we talked about like textures. You can use texture paints to create kind of textured stuff and dirt. This is still wet. Hasn't been 90 minutes because we didn't do this at the immediate start of the show. We have our test base, which we did by applying a layer of white glue, white PVA glue, if you're going looking for it, or just Elmer's glue, not the school glue. Don't get the school glue. You want regular Elmer's glue all. So what we did is we put a layer of white glue down, covered it with our combination of fine and coarse basing material, which I made a combination of, and then put that onto the base. And then we, as that was drying, we covered it with some washes to just see what we were working with. And then we put like flock on to create sort of this autumn foliage in the center. We had some static grass for like kind of a prairie look, and then wildflowers to add some texture and some depth. This is a horse that I did a while ago to kind of give you an idea of, again, of kind of how you can do use all of these techniques kind of together as a singular, item. Then we started to put that into practice. We had just fine grit basing for our bore, a coarse only basing for the Psycho Bear, and then we put some of the grass tufts on it, and then we did a different type of fine basing material on our Iron Golem. We also put this up onto the parts of the base, or parts of the model that were rock-like in texture, to kind of create a smooth, uniform style. We then also did a combination of this fine basing and this coarse basing on our unicorn, which again is drying because there was a lot of glue and it was starting to fall all over the place. And then last but not least, we talked about scenic bases. Actually, here, I'll bring them back on the camera real quick. So these are scenic bases. Again, they're designed to be paintable to do your basing. So you have different designs, textures, and then you just apply colors to them. And then here is our technical paint. We put this onto a scenic base. I'll go ahead and I'll take this, put this in my hand. So this was a scenic base. This was resin cast. It had a bunch of crevices in it to kind of show us our texture. And then we painted it with a neon green and then covered it with a technical paint that's designed to crack and chip. And you can kind of see it happening here in the corners or around these edges here. It hasn't really happened in the center because that paint is still drying. This is something that I'll come back to in a couple hours and it'll look really nice. So basing is not necessary for your minis. Pre-paints like this one here just come with a very solid black base. You can use clear bases so that they look fine on whatever sort of battle mat you're using. Or you can theme them around like the dungeon you find them in. So these are all, maybe be found in different like woodlands or in the Psycho Bear's case, like different parts of like a kind of a science fantasy world for your MCC games. But there's a lot you can do. And even just kind of working with scenic stuff like this is just the beginning. You can steal a lot from model railroaders. They've got books upon books on the stuff. They do it on large scales. We're here doing it on a very small scale. So we've got a little bit of time. So what we're going to do is this is our last brush hour of the year. We'll be back sometime in January. And maybe we will do something. We'll kind of start at the beginning, like how do I start prepping my models? But what we're going to do now, if I can remember where I put my paint water that I went and refreshed, is we're going to clean our brushes. So brush maintenance and brush care is very important. If your brushes are dirty, they're not going to hold paint as well. They're going to split and fray. And just like with any kind of hobby, brushes can be very expensive, and we don't want to, we don't want to waste our money and have to buy new brushes every time we start a new project. So, this is brush soap. Specifically, it is Master's Brush Cleaner and Preserver. I bought this bar of soap in, I don't know, 2012. And I don't use it enough, but I'm still using the same one that I bought. Brush cleaner, brush preserver, like you want to give your brushes a really good like clean water, rinse them out, and then you get the brush wet and you just kind of apply the brush soap and you just sort of drag it across the brush soap. There's some like minor abrasives in there to help with it. And you just do this and you clean it out, clean out your brush, and you bring it back to the soap. And the idea is as you do this, one of the things that I do is I also work a lather up in my hands too, 'cause whatever, my hands, I'll wash my hands, and then clean it out. And you basically do this until the lather is white. So this is a really like I bought this brush for 50 cents. I use it mostly for basing, but it is dirty and you can kind of see it's got color back to it. It was very like black and gray and gross, and I'm just kind of washing it out, getting soap on it, and then kind of working that lather in my hand. And then what I'm also doing is I'm twisting and pulling the brush so that I start to rebuild the tip. Because the tip's what we really want to work with, because that'll hold paint, that'll allow us to create like edge highlights and make sure that when we apply the paints to the models, the paint doesn't go everywhere. So this, like I said, this brush, I bought it for 50 cents. It's splitting. Usually that means that like the brush's life is past. It's is no more. It ceased to be. But I use it for basing, so if it's junky, it's okay. So here are a couple of other brushes that I use today. You can tell, like this army painter, the red one on the right, needs some cleaning because it's curved at the tip. So that's because I used it too often without cleaning it in between. So just like with the really junky brush, I'm going to get it wet in my paint water, and I'm going to drag it along the drag it along, create a lather in my hand, clean it out, bring it, bring it back to the soap. And you do this basically until you can, until like the brush color is back. Let's see if I have another, I don't have another army painter. But like this is kind of what the colors are supposed to look like. They are kind of a light brown. And there's supposed to be a tip there. So we just do that over and over. And I have a couple of brushes that I have to clean. So if there are, I mean, there's a couple of you still watching. Hopefully Dice Station Zebra is still here and hasn't gone to start their holiday meal a couple days early. But if there's any questions that you guys have about miniature painting, about painting in general with regards to this, if you got any questions, let me know. If there's anything you'd like to see in future brush hours, I'm always open to ideas. I've got basically some ideas for next year already brewing, and kind of just making sure that there's I want to paint some minis that are a little bit more module specific. We're just kind of getting started, and in terms of like feeling out what brush hour is besides just me painting and talking for 2 hours or hour 45. But I think next year we might start with some like level zeros, so that our players can have minis because we got tons of monsters to throw at them. But we might start with some stuff like that, a couple of level zeros. And again, I'm just this this there are a couple of other different like brush soaps out there. Different companies have their own style. Masters has kind of been the my go-to, again, besides the fact that I've had it for a decade. It's the one that I recommend. And it's used like you go buy this in an art store. Like it's not something that's specific to miniature painting, it's something that's specific to painting. So we, we're just like we're stealing basing ideas from model railroaders, we are stealing brush care from artists. I mean, we're artists, right? Painting tiny horses, that's art. Hey, if the horses look the right way, then it's a precious moment business.
We're not going to talk about precious moments again.
Again? All right.
We talked about how
So,
creepy they are.
oh yeah. When I was doing some Christmas shopping today, we saw some ornaments that looked very precious moments-y, and it was like, whew. Yeah, no, they're very creepy. Well, a couple of minis that need paint. So you've been looking at some beginner methods. I will say the easiest beginner method is to just do it. Like you can put in a lot of prep and planning and come up with like the perfect color scheme and the different techniques you want to do. And kind of at the end of the day, it's like just gotta paint. I mean, I hope Brush Hour is like providing inspiration. It's providing thoughts on like how you want to paint stuff or how you can paint stuff quickly. Oh yeah, speed paints are excellent. I While I'm cleaning this, this iron golem was done with speed paints. So this is, it's all army painter metallic speed paints. And then I hit it with a wash of, like a rust, an oxide, so that it looked, you know, it looked kind of like a golem that hadn't been used in a long time. Speed paints are great. If you do pick up speed paints, Citadel contrast paints are kind of the first ones that were on the market. They are good. Stock standard, I guess, is the way that I would refer to them. Some of their colors are better than others. Like they've got like 15 different yellows, it feels like, and only one of them's good. Army Painter is really good. That's probably what I would use if I didn't have, or that's what I use in place of certain Citadel colors. But you got to make sure that you get their 2.0 line. 1.0 had some issues with reactivation. I do not, unfortunately, have any experience with the Vallejo Express, which is their speed paints. But I mean, they're supposed to be pretty good. Like when I was starting painting, Army Painter wasn't really up and running. So your options for like hobby paints were Reaper, which does not make a speed paint, I don't believe. Vallejo, which has like model colors, a lot of like tank colors and military colors, and then Games Workshop or Citadel colors. We have a glut of paints to choose from nowadays. But yeah, speed paints are great. We can one of the things I do want to show, if I can figure out my airbrush, if I can get it to not clog, is I can show you kind of like the slap chop method, as it's called, which is where you zenithal highlight, which is black undercoat, and then white or gray, which we kind of did with the undead warlord back in, I think, the beginning of November. And the slap chop method is to like very quickly just create highlights and low lights, and how to kind of make the best of the speed paints, to quickly get something. The reason why they don't call it slap chop because you're slapping paint on it. I mean, I guess that is, but also because the like the old like as seen on TV product where it was like, hey, chop an onion in like 2 seconds. But it works with any speed paint, and it's because Citadel or Games Workshop makes a competitive game, or they make a game, and your force in that game, your army, only has like a limited shelf life before it gets nerfed into the ground or before something new comes out that's better than it. So you want that painted on the table as fast as possible. So you slap chop it, which is contrast paints and extreme light and dark highlights. Citadel's great. Biggest problem is like their paint pots. They paint from the pot instead of a dropper bottle. So like you do lose some paint life with it. And their price. They are the priciest paint on the market in terms of hobby paints. I mean, you can go to like a Michael's or an any other sort of art store and buy more expensive paints that are just, you know, acrylics or oils. But in terms of what we hobby with, Citadel's the most expensive. And I understand that I've been cleaning brushes for like 10 minutes now. But you know, kind of answering questions and seeing what, you know, what everyone's sort of hobby questions might be and or expectations. Like I think my hobby goal for 2024 is to paint a module's worth, a DCC module's worth of miniatures, so that I can say, all right, I'm running this module. I can put a miniature down for every encounter that the players would face. Now I run DCC almost entirely Theater of the Mind, so I could be done with zero. But I do like putting minis down on the table. Even if we don't do like combat, it helps with like just me, it helps me describe what my players are seeing. So in terms of like running games and stuff or playing in games to last brush hour of the year in the last couple minutes, any hobby resolutions for next year? Like, Elena, do you have any?
I'm looking forward to hopefully being able to run more games at the table. But I'm not sure if that's gonna happen,
That's fair.
cuz some of my like I moved away in the su in like September from being close to most of my gaming group. So it's a lot harder for us to get together now.
That's fair. As someone who has like rebuilt my gaming group several times, it's sometimes it's just a mat, just find some schmucks in your everyday life, but that are maybe willing to sit down and roll some dice, which is always hard, especially, well, you, I mean, you work for a game company. You think it'd be easy, but
No, it's not.
yeah. I used to do like minor design work and volunteer for a real independent like tabletop wargaming company, and the games I played least were the two that I helped like design, because I never had time for it. So yeah, I think playing more at the tables like always one that I'm trying to do more of. I'm also trying to see. I want that belt buckle next year. I want to run 13 public games. I keep topping out at like 9 or 10 every year. There's so many games out there, and there's only 52 weeks in a year.
Yeah, seriously. I want to run DCC. I want to run MCC. I've got an America survival guide. I want to do that. I want to play some Dying Earth. So.
I'm kicking myself that I backed out of the X Crawl Kickstarter. But like I want to play that. I got to play an adventure that Brendan was playtesting at a local convention a couple months ago, and I had a blast. I was like, oh, X Crawl is stupid fun. Like I'm super content to just play like high or low fantasy RPGs for like the rest of my life. But X Crawl, like I want to play X Crawl. Like I want to be a professional wrestler dungeon crawler essentially. And I have friends that are interested in it, so I need that to be released like now. All right. So we are at time. So I'm gonna keep cleaning these brushes after the cameras go off. But thank you guys for an incredible couple of months as we painted miniatures and talked about hobbying and how we can like use these in role-playing games. I'll be back in January, unless of course Goodman Games is like, nah, we don't want this anymore. But I hope you all have a great holiday, and I hope you all have a wonderful new year. And I will see you in 2024, hopefully.